The Adam Carolla Show. Adam's guest today, the author of SEAL Team 6, Hunt the Leopard, Ralph Pezzullo. With Gina Grant on news, Bald Brian on sound effects, Dave Damashek's here for good sports, and Larry Miller stops by for the hypothetical road trip game. And now, we know you have lots of choices for podcasts, and we thank you for listening to Adam Carolla.
Yeah, get it on. Have to get it on. No choice but to get on a mandate. You get it on, man. Thanks for tuning in, and thanks for telling a friend. We love that about you. Right, Gina Grant?
That's right.
Handball, Brian.
Tengo Santo Dolores.
All right, so a hypothetical road trip. We got a lot of good contenders this week, so I'm excited about that. I wanted to talk about an interesting thing. I'm working with young Peter, who's heading off to go to Berkeley in a day or so, but he's a philosophy major, and as something about philosophy, oh, I always looked at philosophy as a guy with a cape, and he's like holding a skull and he's looking at it, you know.
Very existential.
And he's like, that's a theater major.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what I've realized is like Stoics and philosophy and stuff like that. It's it should be a part of your life. Okay. It should be a part of today's society. It's old, but it's old like doing exercise is old.
It matters.
It's good for you. And part of where we're bursting at the seams a little bit is not enough of that sort of personal, mental, philosophical hygiene. Yeah. You know, what's right, what is right to do, what's right versus wrong. Forget about all the outside forces. And so I had this conversation with Peter because we're building a home theater. And
when's it gonna be ready? So Natalia's asking.
I give him a few marching orders and then I leave, like rip this wood. He kind of screwed something up, not badly. It didn't matter, but I did say to him something, and he'll tell you what his response was.
So as Nischke would say,
there's a piece of wood. There's a piece of 1x5 wood, and he was having to put it up, and it really didn't make any difference whether he put it up facing this way or facing that way. Meaning, it's like if let's say you're putting baseboard in your house, and the baseboard was just the same shape. It was just 5 inches tall and 3/4 inch wide, and it was just the same. And you'd go, well, it wouldn't really matter what side you put on the ground and what side you put up versus what side, or if you flipped it the other way. But what I said to him, and I'd like you guys to always think about this, is even in complete random situations where there's a situation where you're like, we're going to walk to the liquor store. It's exactly a half mile if you go that way, and it's exactly a half mile if you go the other way. So who cares? There's always other elements involved. Mm. Maybe it's hot and the one way has a little more shade, just a little more, or one's to a tougher neighborhood, or one when you pop out at the liquor store, you're at the back of the liquor store and you have to walk around to the front, or something. There's something. And so I said to him, I told you to rip this piece of 1x down to size. I told you to rip off the side that had the rounded over edge, or kind of a broken edge, as we call it, like just not sharp edge. And he said, yeah, I fucked up. I ripped the other side. And I said, it doesn't make a difference for what we're doing, but get in the habit of stopping all the time and going, is there a better way? And because I said, think about it. Statistically, when's it ever going to be 50-50? When's it going to be exactly? There's no benefit one way or the other. Now, before, when I was talking about putting down this piece of baseboard, maybe there's a knot on one side of it and it would show through the paint. And if you flipped it over and put it against the wall, that'd be it. Mm. Most of these things, nothing's 50-50 statistically. It'd be pretty tough.
A little better one way or the other one.
Sunny here in Italia.
Yeah. Most, the 90-10 things are super easy to figure out.
Right.
They're just They're soup. The 90-10 things. The more the 50-50 is like, we're going to Vegas. Are we driving to Vegas? We fly. Well, by the time you go to LAX and you go through security and sometimes there's flight delays. Yeah, but what if you hit traffic? You know, but okay. That's a little more 50-50. When it comes to New York, then that's at 99.1%. Right. We're flying. Most things are somewhere in between. And oftentimes not super obvious. And you will, so get in the habit. So I was saying all this to Peter. I said, get in the habit of when you come to a kind of crossroads of something where it's like, does it matter if I do it this way or doesn't matter either that way? I guess it doesn't matter either way. Stop yourself, examine it, and try to figure out the 51-49. Just pick that one. Just get in the habit of just a percentage point better. And someone could go, but it doesn't matter.
Over the course of time, it does.
It's you making decisions. Mm. And it helps on the other ones. It helps the ones that are higher or lower because you're constantly in this mode.
Critical thinking. If you can tell,
we can all tell the difference between a 90 and a 10. But if you can tell the difference between 52 and 48, or 50 and a half and 49 and a half, now you've honed your instrument. Now you're sharp. So every time you do something, there's always a way that is a percentage point better way to do it. When you do carpentry a lot, it's a lot of like, well, cut that piece of plywood down to 32 inches and put it on top of the riser. And I'm always like, cut the other end. I want the factory end to the outside. And someone's like, why? Because the cut end is not going to be as nice with the handsaw, with the circular saw. It's not going to be nice at the factory end. And the cut end, I want against the wall because no one's going to see that. Factory end will be the outside.
That's the show end.
So figure out what side the factory edge is and take the factory edge and push that out and put it away. So it's something a little... Yes.
But with these decisions, I imagine maybe you're just that good and you knew it inherently. Don't you have to be burned once? Or ideally once. You have to be burned once, like, that's the lesson. I'll never mess that up again. Like,
yeah, we all it helps.
To, you know, touch that pan that's hot just once.
It helps. And in construction, it happens all the time, and you get mad at yourself. And I just said to him, it's never going to be exactly statistically 50-50. It'll just never be that. It's always going to be a little bit. And so every single time you just stop, and even if it doesn't matter, you get in the habit.
Yeah.
You go through the process and do it. And he said, yeah, that's what makes you a philosopher.
He said, I quit.
I don't think I'm a philosopher. He said, no, that's what philosophers would do. That's a philosophy thing.
Is he majoring in philosophy?
Yeah, but it's, again, It's like, I don't know. Like, we talk about the word juvenile having a weird connotation to it because I always think of juvie hall, juvenile hall, and stuff like that.
Bad
Jews,
connotation.
Never in juvie, ironically. But it's good, man. I mean, when you have to deal with someone who's into philosophy, again, not hippie, I don't feel like working philosophy, but like really philosophy.
Going to apply these principles to other things.
Boy, do you love working with those people. Yeah. You don't get weird excuses. You don't get weird notions. Yeah. You get a lot of reality on reality's terms. You get prompt. You get honest. Like, you get a lot of really killer qualities. It's sort of like, he was in the military, he wrestled in high school. Like, you get those same kinds of qualities because they govern themselves. So, because you can't escape yourself.
Yeah, they're not herd followers. When it comes to all this backlash stuff on college campuses, ironically, the philosophy majors are probably the ones holding their ground.
It's interesting. I'd be curious how that worked. Yes, you'd think they'd be the tip of the spear, but as I think about it, not young Peter. Anyway.
Check in with a young boy in a year and see how he's evolved.
He's probably going to be transitioning.
Reminds me of a great joke from Steve Martin back in his early stand-up days. He too would say, I was a philosophy major in college, which is great, so I can open up a philosophy store afterwards. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea that it wasn't very practical.
My mom would argue that Chicano studies are less profitable. All right, now, Larry's out there. Larry's going to go in. You know what? Hold Larry for a second. I was going to play this clip. Somebody sent me a clip, as I've been screaming about for a million years, what's going on with allergies. There's no way this is just cropped up. We're doing it to ourselves. All Rich Whitey bathing in Purell can't be good.
Got exposed early.
Got exposed. Like, I've just been saying it and saying it and saying it, and everyone's been whack. I'll tell you, when you have a kid, especially when you have twins, it's nonstop Purell talk. Don't pick up the kid. You got to sanitize before you
latex
do anything.
Gloves.
On the flip side, we're leaving Tessa with grandma right for next week for vacation when we're on a dark week. And Chrissy's mom says, "Can I send her to school?" So we're making lunch, obviously. "Can I send her to school with a peanut butter and jelly sandwich?" And Chrissy's like, "If you want her to get expelled." Like, they have a hard line against peanut butter.
Well, we're going to find out where these where it all came from. I'll play this clip. I someone sent it to me online. Thanks. National Post.
Here's a fun fact about the Amish. They don't really get allergies. That's right. While you city dwellers are making a lunch run for dairy-free, gluten-free, sugar-free, nut-free, vegan kale wraps, most Amish can chow down on whatever. A 2012 study of Amish children in Indiana found that only 7% had some kind of allergy sensitization, compared to 36% of American children as a whole. This is an important fact because, if you haven't noticed, the allergy rate in the Western world is getting kind of nuts. In the United States, shellfish allergies have gone up 40% in just the last 15 years, and nut allergies have quadrupled. In the UK, hospital admissions for allergies have gone up 500% since 1990, with British children also undergoing a five-fold increase in the rates of peanut allergies. So what's going on? Why are the Amish happily chugging milk and breathing pollen while the rest of us can't so much as look at a plate of pad thai? For one thing, we haven't been parenting our kids right. For a long time, the advice was to not expose your kids to potentially harmful allergens until they were older. Parents were told not to feed their kids peanuts until age 3, for instance. Now, it turns out that this was all wrong. By denying children early exposure to allergens, it was actually causing them to become allergic. One particularly illuminating study looked at the peanut allergy rates among Jewish children in Israel and Jewish children in the UK. They're both Jewish, so allergy rates should be about the same, right? Wrong. The British kids had a rate of peanut allergy 10 times higher than the Israeli kids. The reason? Israelis were chowing down on peanuts as babies, whereas Brits weren't getting peanuts until they were toddlers. The result was that by the time many Brits got their first taste of peanut, their bodies couldn't handle it. It turns out there's a brief window of time after you're born in which your body is super receptive to unfamiliar foods and won't react to them. Miss that window, and boom, you're allergic. That's why groups like the United States National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases are now advising parents to load up their kids with potentially allergenic food, including peanut butter, before the age of 6 months. Another explanation for our now spiking allergy rates is called the hygiene hypothesis. The gist is that by living super sanitized, HEPA filter, Purell soaked lives, we are becoming increasingly fragile people unable to stomach even our own food. Some of the most compelling evidence is that farm children are consistently less allergenic than children living in cities. The same is true of rich countries versus poor countries. A 2007 study in the American Journal of Respiratory and Critical Care Medicine found that the more developed the country, the higher were the rates of allergy-induced asthma. Of the places probed by the study, the city with one of the lowest rates of allergic asthma was Mumbai, India, a place known for many things, with cleanliness not being one of them. The phenomenon has even been noticed among migrants. Immigrants from a low-allergy country like Turkey or Egypt move to a Western country like Canada or the United States. Then, when they have their first kids in the West, those kids are just as racked with allergies and asthma as the other kids in their play school. Allergies are caused by your immune system mistaking harmless things for pathogens and then shifting into high gear to battle it. The hygiene hypothesis holds that those of us in the West aren't giving our immune systems a proper workout, so it's essentially shorting out and treating everything like a threat. You're never going to completely get rid of allergies.
All right.
Even Amish
you
kids
can stop them. All right, look, everybody.
He made his point.
Everybody.
We get it.
Do you want to hear anything else about what the experts have to tell us? The experts, they had the fucking food pyramid flipped upside down.
Right.
The experts did. The experts are telling us that The homeless population, only 16% of them have issues with substance. The
rest, it's
the high cost of living.
Right.
And you want to hear what else the fucking experts have to say, or do you want to fucking listen to grandma who knew what was going on?
They'll change their message every 10 years with a straight face. Be like, oh, we had it wrong.
Let me tell you something, Gina. Hold your ear.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
Everything is fear-based. It's all fucking fear-based. It's all fear. All right, fucking Russians have hacked our election. Now Trump's a Klansman. You know, he's white. He's whistled. There's this giant surge of white supremacy and Klans activities just surging in our country. It's running in our midst. And the fucking bees are coming. The killer bees are coming. Everything's coming. Your kid, get used to Perel. It's all fucking fear-based. It's all fear-based. Everything's fear. That's how you get people motivated. You know, you don't go, hey, do the right thing, or you use horse sense or whatever. No. It's we will scare you. It's all fucking mother's nightmare. It's all the moms are doing the shopping. Our job is to scare the shit out of the moms. Now, just the moms who have the money. We don't care about the poor brown moms or the black moms. Ironically,
they're not going to buy HEPA filters.
Their kids are healthier. But let's get the moms. Let's get the moms who have the money. Let's get the moms who are completely fear-based. They're set to fear. That they are on, they are fear sponges that just go, please bring the fear to me. Please. It's my mother's nightmare to not have Purell for my fucking kids. So I'm fear-based. Now, Procter & Gamble and the government and everyone else, you scare me, and then I'll take some money, and I'll go somewhere, and I'll get these products, and I'll do all of this shit. And, of course, it becomes a multi-zillion dollar business. Now, at a certain point, then later on, when the kids are dying of white lung and we figured out that spraying all the sunscreen on their face and all over their bodies has permeated their skin and poisoned their fucking their blood system, then there'll be another lawsuit or something like us, and then the moms will get scared about that, and then they'll double back and want to have testing for their kids to see if, because there's a class action lawsuit because Procter & Gamble made sunscreen, and they prayed, and this kid breathed it in, but then on the label it said you should hold a handkerchief in front of your mouth, but no one ever did. It's just fear, 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 and more fucking fear equals pay me.
Right.
That's how it works. All the true crime shows, that's it. Let's get some eyeballs. Let's sell some. Right. And by the way, once we get all the nutty broads watching all the true crime shows, we're going to sell them some Purell.
Sure.
We're going to sell them some sunscreen. We're going to have... Okay, it's anyone else figured this out? Why do we go along with it?
I'd like to point out how complicit the media is also, because Gina, you get the news services every day. Every 2 months, it's, turns out coffee is bad for your nervous system. Turns out coffee is great for your heart. Yep. Turns out coffee is bad. Every 2 months, there's a conflict. Red wine. Red wine is bad for your arteries. Turns out red wine is great for your brain. It's always a conflict, and they're always running with it like it's breaking news.
I know. Again,
breaking news.
Everyone was eating snack wells and margarine because we're trying to do the right thing.
Diet right.
Just everyone, you know what the answer is. Just whatever the fucking Amish do, they're fine.
that was never the answer.
Just go raise a barn and shut the fuck up.
Churn something.
And listen, I don't know. I get that fear sells, and I get people have a gear for fear.
Well done.
Because... There's two types of attention that people like. They like any kind of attention, honestly.
But also?
There's no middle ground of attention, really. What there is you are the best, or you have a target on your back.
Mm.
They're both attention. One is, that feels good. The other feels bad, but it's a more direct type of attention, if you really think about it. And if you hear, by the way, you don't believe it, if you want to see the same thing out of the same mouth, the biggest pompous ass is athletes on the planet, like in the NFL, they're going, hey man, we got a target on our back. The whole league is gunning for us. There's nobody but the people in this locker room
that believe in us.
Who believe in us. And then they start going, I'm the best, and that's why I have a target on my back. This is all roads lead to narcissism. Being the best and or having a target on your back, thus fear, is a narcissistic thought. This is what people do, And this is what motivates. And so all we do is try to scare the fuck out of everybody. Tears for fears.
Gears for fears.
Gears for fears.
Oh, Brian.
Now, I don't know.
I love this song.
Are we not smart enough at this point to not fucking dive on every dollar that's got a piece of fishing string tied to it that's on the sidewalk after we've skinned our knees the last 1,000 days in a row diving for that dollar? Are we just going to go for it again? That every fucking time the news agents or Procter & Gamble or whomever just tosses out this thing, we just got to fucking dive on it every time.
Right.
Every time.
Like the fish is the other fish. Like, we're not falling for that lure again. Ooh, look, shiny. Exactly.
Every time.
Yeah.
And I've had the conversations with, like, oh, no, they got to, the kids got to shower before they go to bed. I'm like, no, they don't. Who cares? And it's always, it's mistake. There's two things. One is, oh, you don't care.
Yeah.
Which is true. But the reason I don't care is because the shower doesn't make a fucking difference, and neither does a Purell, and it's also going to hurt them, big, big picture. But when are we going to stop diving for the next one? That's all I'm saying.
Oh, never.
I don't give a shit what comes out next. I'm just going to go about my fucking life. And we never stop, and it's and the reason, Dawson, you haven't 50 years will all be chicks. I think I covered this, but this is chick think, it's not dude think, and we've convinced a lot of fucking soft dudes to think like chicks, and that's where we're at right now, everybody. And if you want to know why it's an epidemic, it used to be a balance. It is no longer a balance. There are plenty of lesbian couples where one of them has a cock. Plenty of fucking lesbian couples where one is swinging a ball and cock.
It's just in.
But it's every bit is fucking chickies you could imagine. They are like fucking, I know lesbian couples where one of them has a dick. And I won't say which one.
Thank you. They know.
Dawson, did I catch this? Which chapter is this in? Two?
Chapter two.
All right. Should we bring Larry in? All right. Go ahead and read
this
it. Sorry to bring Larry in.
The next thing we removed was peanuts. Now, I know a lot of you assholes have a friend who works with someone who once was date raped by a guy whose stepson was in Cub Scouts with a kid whose half-brother is allergic to peanuts. I feel sorry for that kid, but that doesn't mean the other 2,000 kids in his school should be denied the simple pleasure of the peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Once again, we have put the individual ahead of the group. How many of these kids truly have a nut allergy? I'm not saying there's no such thing as a kid who would go into anaphylactic shock if he keistered a payday. I'm saying our paranoia has turned a rare occurrence into a full-blown epidemic. My kid's preschool adopted a no-nuts policy. I'm happy to report that last year, when they asked me to MC their charity bake sale, I explained to them that I also have a no-nuts policy. I don't MC bake sales for paranoid nut jobs. How is it I managed to be warehoused at one of the largest junior highs in the country with nary a kid allergic to peanuts, and now every third kid on my block has to carry a fucking syringe full of epinephrine,
I think.
Thank you. Epinephrine. Have we changed physiologically in that short a period of time? Or is it, as I suspect, an emotional change? I saw an episode of 60 Minutes a couple years ago where a team of doctors came up with a paste to feed the malnourished children of... Are you sitting down? Africa. The paste consisted of powdered sugar, powdered milk, and peanut butter. It was called Plumpy Nut and was so effective that it brought entire villages from the brink of death up to the health standards of America. Colonial America. During the interview, when the doctor was boasting about this amazing achievement, Anderson Cooper asked, "But what about the peanut allergies?" The doctor explained, "It's not a problem there." So why is it that kids who are severely malnourished and basically have the immune system of a rat at an AIDS hospice aren't allergic to peanuts? I contend it's because they have real problems. We've run out of real problems, so now we manufacture invisible ones. We now live in a society where everything's an emergency, and we won't acknowledge a difference between the people who get hives from peanuts and the ones whose windpipes will swell shut. So who shall we blame? I blame us, because we caved to the hypochondriac, red book reading, Oprah watching, crystal rubbing, whole food shopping survivor of incest moms and their pussy whipped attorney husbands.
Wow. 10 years ago.
It's powerful.
Thank you, Dawson. Thank you. But don't listen to me. What the fuck do I know? Jesus Christ. Hey, Larry.
Hi, Adam.
Hello, Larry. Larry Miller is in studio to play the hypothetical road trip game. I've listened to a few of those on, what's that podcast? Carolla's Best.
Cool, Classics.
Classics.
Hosted by Gio and Chris Waxman.
Very well executed podcast.
Do you have more notes on how to execute that podcast?
No. A couple small edit notes. That's all. So, not editing notes. These are talent based.
Yeah, these are more performance oriented.
I want to bring in Rogan and Stanhope to, you know.
Like you said, not everything's 50-50. You got to find the 49-51.
All right. So we have hypothetical road trip. Mm-hmm. We have my liked tweets. There's a Guardian article talking about more people not using soap once it's on the same theme. I don't know. You want to read the first passage of that? It's just people are saying nope to soap.
Yeah, it
I'm fucking turning to Nipsey Russell this day. Yes.
Yeah. I'm pulling the article up now. But it was published this week and everybody's been tweeting at you. It's called "I Don't Smell, Meet the People Who Have Stopped Washing." A growing number of people are eschewing soap and trusting bacteria to do the job instead, and an entire industry has sprung up to accommodate them. And it's talking about guys who haven't showered or bathed in 15 years.
Yeah.
No way.
But
Adam's role models.
But no body odor on these people.
Well, you know, one thing I have learned, early with zits. You'd see all these commercials when I was growing up, like, oh man, you got to get the Neutrogena soap and you got to scrub. Yeah. You got to scrub hard. You got to get
OxyClean.
You got to get the pumice, the stuff that has the ground up apricot seeds in it. You scrape off that first layer of zit, man. You clean out the pores. Look. What you have for lunch? Pizza?
Right.
Yeah. You see the oily slick on top of the
pizza?
It's coming
out of your skin now.
That's what's got in the bridge of your nose.
Yeah.
Don't you know anything about physiology or biology? I was thinking biology.
I was a philosophy major. I'm sorry.
Yeah. You bite the pizza. It's got the oil. Now the oil, where's your oil go? Mm-hmm. Comes out your nose.
Right to the nose.
Right.
But my stone fruit pumice.
It's oily, and you gotta scrub it. Right. You gotta scrape it, and all it did was agitate and inflame everything and sort of everything. Best thing you can do with a zit is basically leave it alone or give it a little dab Oxy-10 and go to bed. Right. Your whole body's kind of that way. Like, the more you go at it, the more... No, not your asshole. Give that a nice wipe. But what I'm saying is, like, when you go at parts of your body, it your body then pushes back. But yes.
A wise man named Adam Carolla once pointed out the absurdity, and I agree, of, like, fitness models or just models or whoever, people in great shape saying, like, here's how you lose the weight. Here's how you keep the weight off. It's like you're fucking genetically blessed with a beautiful body. Of course, you know how to keep the weight off.
Right.
It's genetics. Wouldn't that be the obvious answer to people who do, I don't smell? It's like, yeah, you're probably of a bloodline that produces less pheromones or hormones or whatever in your goddamn armpits. Some people really smell. You ever driven in a cab? People really fucking smell.
Well, look, let's leave the Swedes out of this.
Did I say something? I was thinking it, but
you said cat.
I don't remember. Yeah, okay. Yeah,
we pictured New York. We know the stereotype.
But
the point is this. Some people genetically do have a predisposition for that, just like they do in the gut with the flora and the fauna in the bowel. Some people's farts not so bad, others bad. There's a predisposition to that. I think what the science is saying is if you have that condition, the scrubbing doesn't help it exacerbates it. Now, I'm not saying don't put on some deodorant before you leave the house, but I think the constant scrubbing brings out more of whatever your bad wiring is. Larry?
Adam!
Hypothetical road trip game. Also, somebody sent me a song that was the theme song when I was looking for our Van Nuys theme song, our cruising night.
Wednesday night was cruising night. Did we ever find that?
We never found it. We found a different version of it, which was not the Wednesday night is cruising night in Van Nuys. And then someone sent me my super depressing. Well, we can hear the song, the one that person sent me at least.
When's this from?
Oh, let me listen. 2007? Can't tell. This is back when you could take up three quarters of a movie or any detective show showing a good-looking guy driving confidently. Like, that was all you needed. Like, you'd watch a whole episode of Mannix. It was just like, hey, that guy's he's in a Mustang, and he looks like he knows where he's going.
That was the first act.
Like, just driving, looking confident.
Compelling you gotta
have
story
a arc. Good ride and a good chin, and you're in good shape in the 70s.
Or two pretty women who look at each other and laugh.
Yes.
You know what? I'm going to file the minority report on this. Isn't that a bad song? The song kind of cooks.
It's got the Van Nuys in it.
I got no problem with this song.
I wonder if the guy who was penning this song was like, recede Inland Empire. Oh, Rancho Cucamonga. Okay, that's horrible. You're right. North Hollywood. Yeah, let's see.
You only need the two syllables.
He's going down to Cruise Van Nuys Boulevard.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah. Wednesday night was cruising night in Van Nuys.
In one direction, apparently.
Well, they turn around, I guess, and go the other direction. All right. Larry Miller, I know the Jews love to cruise.
You know what? That's on my family crest.
The Jews love to cruise.
Yes. And who doesn't?
Just you guys wearing yarmulkes and a lowered Impala.
And then we turn and smile at each other.
The Impala's got a yarmulke.
Maybe just call it a roof. All right,
Ragtop.
It's a soft top.
There's that.
Gina.
Oh, stars Cynthia Wood, 1974 Playmate of the Year. Ooh,
yeah,
let's get a look at her.
A shot.
All right, we have a hypothetical road trip to play with Larry. Should we fire it up?
It's the hypothetical road trip game. The game where there are no wrong answers.
We're driving to Florida!
Okay, Larry, this one, we'll start easy.
Let me just say, I know you'll start easy, and let me just say, I'm ready.
I like to get out of the gate with some momentum. You do stand-up. You'll be doing stand-up at Laughs with Bald Brian, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's coming up on November 1st.
Second?
November 2nd, I'll be there. Yeah. So you get out of the gate with a strong joke, right?
Yep.
Get that audience going.
Always.
Right. And that's what I'm doing here. It gives you confidence. It gives the audience confidence. That's what I'm going to do here with our hypothetical drive from the Santa Monica Pier to Epcot Center in Florida.
That's right.
Start off with a layup. You ready?
Yes.
Adult male who saw Detective Pikachu in theaters but did not bring his kid. Simply went alone to see the Pikachu detective movie alone. Mm. Or woman who protests dressed as handmaid from Handmaid's Tale.
Dressed as Alfred.
Mm-hmm.
First of all, you did start easy.
Yep.
Because any guy who goes to that movie alone without his kids is too desperate and ill to ever be with on a road trip for more than 100 yards.
Mm.
I would never drive with him from... Well, Santa Monica to Epcot Center, or from Santa Monica to Santa Monica and a half.
Mm, mm-hmm.
I wouldn't do any of that.
Mm.
I will always take that woman in the, slightly crazy fashion outfit, because every time I got sick of it, I can remind myself, yes, but I didn't have to drive with the guy who went to the movie like a lunatic.
Mm. Oh,
come on!
Larry,
that was the easy
that
one!
That was sound!
That was an easy one!
I'll tell you what.
It seemed airtight.
I gotta apologize, because you did have that one right.
Yeah.
I just found out that guy directed the film.
Duh!
And he was there to obviously watch the work from a critical standpoint, and he could have given you a lot of work.
Come on!
As an actor, Larry.
Sure!
If it was just a guy... No problem.
Sure.
You win, hands down. But I was just informed that guy actually directed the Pikachu film. It's a pretty big Ryan Reynolds.
Yeah, it's a big release.
That guy's the kind of guy
he could throw.
I mean, you're a fine character actor. He could throw some work your way.
Absolutely.
That would have been an incredible networking opportunity
on the
road for a week.
Well, let me ask you one question.
And Larry, again, you were right. I have just informed who that guy was.
You know what? One quick question.
Yes.
You were just informed?
I had an inkling as I was driving in today, but I didn't know until moments ago.
Well, I had the same inkling.
And I'm
but
so sorry,
yeah.
Larry.
Judge's just you gotten were, his ears.
I was about to have Brian hit the...
Yeah,
the ding ding.
The ding,
I didn't
yeah.
know we had
really?
The sound, but...
Oh, it's there.
Oh, it's there. Okay, I was
you
gonna...
almost told him to hit the
well,
ding.
Well, you were right, technically, but yeah, then we asked for some ID, and now we have a different outcome.
It's okay.
Man, that was that was close, Larry.
Usually it's just a type, but this is actually a specific person. He does a lot of animated films. That's voiceover work, easy money, you know what I mean?
Like, oh, like Larry.
Mailbox
really
money.
Paid off. So, a lot of money left
you
on the dashboard
smell the money,
of that
so
car.
Can I.
All right, and let's pick up the pieces.
Okay.
Guy who's already in this... middle of June, middle of August. The guy's already picked out his Halloween costume.
Oh, Jesus.
It's adult male. Mm-hmm. He is not a director. I want to be clear. Okay? He has picked out his Halloween costume already, or guy who loves to go on golfing trips with his wife.
Oh, well, that last little bit really hit harder.
Literally a tough putt.
That kind of sprung back at the end there on that one. You know what, though? I have to say, similar to the last one, any guy who's thinking about his Halloween costume and has already picked one out in August for Halloween at the end of October is nuts. And I don't want to be with a guy who's nuts. I really don't.
Mm-hmm.
I had some more that would have been better, I'm sorry Larry would have been funny.
You locked it in. The guy who loves going on golfing trips with his wife is in constant communication with his wife, so his phone is constantly ringing. Like when you travel with Dr. Drew, all you hear is him on the phone with his wife trying to get off the phone with his wife with the succession of okay, we'll do. We'll do. See. You. Ladies, if you hear "we'll do" or "I'll see you then" three times in a row,
wrap it up.
Wrap it up. They're trying to get the fuck off. The, okay, well then I'll see you then.
Sounds
okay, we'll
good.
Do. Okay, we'll do. Okay, we'll. Yeah, I'll see you. It's funny. He'll get rebooted. That's the thing. Like he'll go. We'll do. Okay. See you then. Well, all right. We'll do. Okay. Well, I haven't seen Jordan's retainer. No, I don't know what that is. Ask Delia. Okay. We'll do. We'll do. Once in a while, he gets rebooted with a question. But then, well, okay. See you then. So this guy's constantly going to be on the phone with his wife, but he's not going to want to get off the phone. He's going to be checking in every mile marker. Oh, we entered Arizona today. Woo. He's going to call his wife.
And he's going to drag you into it on FaceTime, on Skype. Say hi to Larry. Larry, wave.
Yeah.
I know, but remember, he's your friend. And I could just kill him. And I could take one of the pistol
in.
Is under the dashboard, like in a Philip Marlowe movie. And you know what? I know how hellish that can be. But I still say no. A guy who picks... And I know you buzz me wrong, you guys... Why don't you spend some time picking your Halloween costumes,
Let's just do one more and see if we can figure this out. All right. Guy, we've talked about this guy, the guy who hikes through Runyon Canyon. He's got no shirt on, but he is wearing a vest, but it's a weighted vest. And he's making sure that everyone knows that hiking, the mere act of hiking, not enough for this guy.
Not strenuous
he has
enough.
To weight himself down. The weighted vest guy... You picturing this guy?
Oh, yes.
Might have a man bun going. We don't know. And
is he a director?
Well, we got to wait till Larry answers, obviously, before that information comes in. And or guy who tasted jackfruit, which I guess is like a meat substitute, and is never going back to meat again. He tasted it one time. Wow. He's never going back.
I can't travel with a guy who has bad food taste like that. I can't do it. I don't want to stop here. Oh, we'll go through the middle of Alabama somewhere. He's got to go find this stand 40 miles off the road.
Right.
And I can't do it.
Obviously.
So I will man bun aside, which would normally be a capital offense.
No, I get it. The food is a big deal when you travel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I would say no, never to the guy with the bad food taste. Come on!
Oh, wow.
Come on! Come on!
Yeah,
Larry,
I was expecting that.
First off, you make perfect sense.
Almost too much sense.
Even though you're wrong, you're not really wrong, you know, in this one. And I feel your pain. Unfortunately, the guy with the weighted vest, he travels with weighted vests.
Oh.
He's got the ankle weights. He's got the wrist weights. He's probably got some dumbbells. He travels. Your mileage, Larry.
Oh, yeah.
The mileage. The weight is the enemy.
He won't let you just stop anywhere, too. Like, no, you can't stop here. Not good hiking. Can't stop here. No fitness room.
But just a trunk filled with sand. You know what I mean?
Well,
you know
what, though?
And just the mileage to Florida. Look, if you're going across town, so be it. But if you're driving cross country with all that weight, sorry.
All that weight, when it's tied around him, we'd drag him to the bottom of any river we passed.
Mm. All right, now you're saying you're ready to commit murder, capital murder.
Twice in one game?
Well.
All right, Larry, I'm sorry. Look, we play. We always root for you. You got a lot of fans here. Everyone's got their fingers crossed. But
this is not your day.
The first one... That was tough because you couldn't have known that guy actually directed the film.
Yeah, that was almost a trick, but you know, you can see where he would go the other way.
Well, I got the information.
Yeah.
I can't sit on it.
Yeah.
So would you say I'm really getting closer?
Well, you were almost 1 for 3.
Yeah,
you
one was a
you
technicality.
You were this close to being 33%.
Okay. You
so,
know what?
Okay.
I'll do it again.
Sorry, Larry. Better luck next time you play the hypothetical road trip game.
It's why I watch the Special Olympics. It's the attitude. It's not. They're not setting records.
But they're smiling.
There's a lot of can-do spirit.
That's the can-do spirit. Sure, the guy holding the blind guy's hand beat them across the finish line, but
that's
everyone's a winner. That's not the point. And that's what I love about Larry.
You're a winner just by participating.
Yeah.
That's right.
I'm a winner, and I'm getting closer.
Yeah. He's getting closer.
You showed up.
All right, let me hit the Castrol Challenge. You can tweet us your questions at Adam Carolla Show with hashtag Castrol Challenge with your question for Castrol Challenge. Brought to you by Castrol Edge, formulated with fluid titanium technology, reduces friction, maximizes engine performance. Three times,
fool.
Stronger against viscosity breakdown than leading full synthetics. What's our question, Max Pata?
At KaiserCA75 on Instagram wants to know, hashtag Castrol Challenge, have you ever thought of getting Natalia into go-kart racing?
Ooh.
With her daredevil attitude and quick reflexes, she would kick ass. Lynette would probably have a heart attack, though.
That's a great question.
Natalia is teaching herself to play the ukulele, which is annoying and interesting simultaneously. Natalia is starting to go down the girly route and a little less of the kick-ass route, so she's getting into more of the girl stuff. She'd be into it. She did. It's always interesting to me. The cause, she hopped on a motorized electric bike. We have like footage of it once at the other shop.
Right.
She jumped on it. Sonny wouldn't go near it, but she jumped on it, and she did. Every single time you see one of those videos from foul-ups, fuck-ups, and bloopers, and grandma got on the moped in the backyard or whatever, it's always the same thing. The throttle of a motorcycle, moped, electric bike, the throttle's always back.
Yeah.
The motion you make when you're panicking and falling off the back of the mini bike is that motion.
Make it go faster.
So you see all these people, they're like, oh, and all of a sudden the front wheel's off the ground and they're dragging behind and they're feeding the fire.
Yeah.
And I was standing there and I saw Natalia like take off, and I realized after about 15 or 20 feet, she clearly didn't have control. Like, we have footage of her skating, going along, and just plowing into a table and falling
she
over.
She took out an end table.
And I was standing there, and I realized there's nothing she... So what I was... You can't really yell anything. I mean, here's what I was yelling. You can't yell, like, slow down or stop.
Yeah, what does that mean?
Or like, one time... It is funny when people yell. I've never told you this before, but I had a friend named Tom Dent. He was our black friend who was rich. His dad was a hand surgeon, I remember. So we were all poor and white, and he was rich and black, so we kind of flipped the script. And one time we're in the parking lot of the bowling alley over here, where the deli Pickwick is and everything. Or, yeah, whatever it is. And we're like, we're going around in a circle on our bikes. We're kind of playing chicken. We're going around. And of course, I was kind of balls out about everything. So I went around, and he was circling. It was like two big circles, and we're circling, and I was clearly just coming right at him. And I was coming at him hard, and I was on my bike, and he was on his bike. And he yelled, "Turn back." But that's impossible. I was like flying at him. Like it was like if a plane was about to hit the side of a mountain and the pilot yelled, "Turn back," to the other pilot, like as it's hitting.
Too late.
Like he yelled it as it's hitting. And I realized people in those situations, they yell stop or slow down or nothing ever works. Yeah. The person is panicking. All I could yell at my daughter was, "Let go with your right hand. Just let your it's counter." She never did it, of course. I couldn't think of anything to yell that. I know you have it floored. I know you can't stop yourself. You're panicking right now. You just have
let go.
But she didn't let go. She was plowing the side of the thing. I think
that being said,
I think she'd be into it, and I will run that up her flagpole and see if she salutes. But I got to tell you, at a certain point, the girls are so much into what the other girls are into or what their friend is doing or what the Kardashians are doing or what they're seeing on TV or whatever. The boys are a little more like either it sounds like fun or it doesn't sound like fun. It's a little less social. This person's doing it, so now I'm interested in it, or I want to get with it. They want to fit in. They want to be in the club. You know, so if I could get one of her friends to get into go-karting.
Cammy and Natalia, duo racers.
I think, thanks, Castrol Edge, by the way, for supporting that long-winded question. Max Pata, you have Adam Carolla's Unprepared.
Yes.
This is from where?
This is from Canyon Club in Agora Hills.
Agora Hills, Canyon Club, a couple of weeks ago. I'm going to be at the Golden State Theater in Monterey doing the this funny conversation. I was doing a little press for that this morning, calling into a local radio station. That'll be August 17th. Doing Unprepared with Adam Ray. And the woman I was talking to, she was like, "I've done my homework on you." And she was telling me about Catch a Contractor and talking about Mangria and talking about books and talking about, oh, and she kept saying, "I did my homework." And then at a certain point, she says, do you get out to the Monterey area, you know, very often?" I'm like, "Yeah, every year I'm racing a car." And she's like, "You're racing a car? What car?" And I'm like, "Well, it's Monterey Car Week and I'm racing." And she's like, "You are?" And I'm like, "Yes, I'll be at the track. What are you racing?" "I'm racing Paul Newman's 1979 Porsche 935. He ran at Le Mans." And she went, "Le Mans? I used to go to Le Mans when I was a little baby. I grew up in England. We'd go to Le Mans." I said, "Were you there in 1979? Because if you were, you saw this car once." She went, "Oh my God." And I was like, "Well, I guess she did a lot of prep, but not kind
but
of
my homework.
Not really that kind." Awesome. I talked to two people. They were both had no idea that I was coming out there racing a car and then doing the show, which is a weird way to prep for someone who's coming out there. But I don't know, Larry, you racing your car later today? I guess I'm guilty of this. I didn't ask.
Yes, but you know what? Just for fun.
Just for fun, and not for pinks.
No, on the way back after the show today. Mm. I'm going to call home before I leave the lot here and just see if Eileen or one of my kids needs anything from Ralph's. Mm-hmm. And then watch what happens.
Oh, really? Wow.
And then I hit that freeway. Mm. And you know what? It gets hit.
Oh, I see. Yeah. Yeah. I like that.
So, yes.
Ralph Pezzullo's here. God, that guy knows everything about all the special ops and forces and everything. Anyway, this is a little clip of dog grooming Chris Maxipata got down from a few weeks ago. Pet grooming from Canyon Club. Somebody pulled the ping pong ball out.
Oh, dude, this is great. Pet grooming. Come on.
I do like the idea that there's pet grooming. I like the idea that everyone who brings their fucking dog to the pet groomer because we're all such narcissistic douchebags, and everyone knows we're narcissistic douchebags. So the people who run the pet groomer thing, whenever they give you your dog back, they're always like, oh, Phil's a sweetheart. We all fucking love Phil the best. Like, we're all excited when Phil shows up. And then my wife comes home and they go, she's like proud. She's like, guess whose dog's the favorite over the pet grooming place? Let me guess, our fucking dog. Like, when she was done running your credit card for $137, that's when they're like, oh, by the way, he's our favorite. Every fucking dog. I don't know what Hitler's dog's name was, but if Lucky or Lady. It was Lady, right? Either way, if Hitler's fucking dog showed up to the pet groomer's place, they'd be like, that's our favorite German Shepherd. We fucking love that dog. That's awesome. Keep up the good work. Godspeed. And then Eva Braun would like get back to the Eagle's Nest, and she'd be like, hey, Fuhrer, guess whose dog's number one over the grooming place? By the way, this whole notion of being a veterinarian, this notion, like, what a fucking job.
Yeah.
This job of, like, I've had the dog. I had a blonde lab, like, got the cancer, got everything, started falling apart at the end. Fucking dumped, like, 50 grand into this dog for, like, the last year and a half, right? What a job veterinarian is. Because imagine this job. Like, they go, well, we're going to operate on the dog, and, I mean, it's probably going to be about 13 grand, 13 to 18 grand, but, you know, it may not work out. Like, there's a good chance it may not work out. I mean, it's still going to be 15 grand, but no guarantees. And the fucking rich chicks just cry and go, oh, no, yeah, no, do what you got to do. Imagine if you were a fucking roofer and this is how you work. Like, hey. Yeah, we're going to go with a 3-tab presidential shingle on their asphalt. It's going to be 22 grand. It may not work out. Next time it drizzles, your fucking kid's race car bed may just flow down the fucking street. We don't know. We don't know. No guarantees. Just go ahead and cut us a check.
Yeah.
You know, it may work. It may not work.
Yeah.
I don't know.
You're rolling the dice.
Yeah. I do car detailing. It's going to be 13 grand. It may look good. We may be able to buff off some of that, some of the scratches on the outer coat.
I feel like there's a butt coming.
I may just shit on your hood. We don't know. We just don't know. But go ahead and cut me a check. Just go ahead and cut that check.
Yeah, also, there's no reporting. Oh, Hitler's dog was Blondie?
Yeah, you said Lady and Lucky.
Yeah. It was something in there.
It's weird that Chris would know that off the top of his head.
Yeah. Real mind comp enthusiast.
You know, everyone else reports back on everything, but the pets, you know, they're like what the pirates say about dead men. They tell no tales, you know? You really don't know what the hell was going on in there.
Yeah, you probably don't want to know.
You don't want to know? Maybe nothing was going on in there. I had the greatest, by the way, The simplest pleasure in life is Phil was my daughter threw herself like a girls' pool party, and there was like eight of her friends all jumping in and out of the pool yesterday, and two of them were hell bent on washing Phil. They got a 110-pound lab. We're gonna give him a bath, and I was like, oh yeah. And then they were like, yeah, we have big dogs at home and we love it. And I'm like, good. And I just dragged Phil over to them, and you know, just got the shampoo and the sponge, and they got the hose out, and it's just these girls just washing this massive dog. And I've just made sure and went out there and sort of drank it in, because it's such a simple visual pleasure. Phil's just standing there, just sort of taking it all in. Then after about 5 minutes, he did his massive shake, and they all started screaming because the suds were flying off him and everything. Like, that's why you should have a dog. Like, those kinds of moments. Yeah. You know what I mean? It drives me nuts when people, you know, they go, well, you get the dog, then you got to get the dog food, then you got to clean up the shit, then you got to take care of the dog. It's like, yes, you have to take care of a car, you have to take care of a condo, you have to take care of everything.
It's akin to the Christmas tree argument. It's like, oh, you got to buy it, you got to drag it in, you got needles everywhere, you got to water it, it starts to dry. Yes, and it's wonderful.
Larry, you know.
Yes,
well, actually, I do know, and you know what? I was just saying this afternoon before coming over here that because one of my kids was there, and he's playing with the he's the Marine, the sergeant, and he's playing with the dogs. The dogs are on his lap, and he made himself a sandwich and brought it to the couch. And he says, you know, it's funny. You never really know what dogs are thinking. And the second he sat down with that sandwich, they both just leapt up, their medium-sized dogs, and sat down and stared right at him at the sandwich. And I said, well, if you had to guess, what would you think they're thinking now? Just go crazy. Just pick something.
Any old thing.
What could it be?
Let the mind wander.
Sure, maybe taking a nap, or maybe what you're eating. So you kind of, then we laughed about it because you more or less always know that one's a boy dog and one's a girl dog. And, well, he goes over to the girl dog kind of every minute to jump on her.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't need me to say anything more than that.
That's right.
And what do you think he wants then?
Yeah.
Once his taxes done.
Yeah, they're pretty limited. Larry Miller, the podcast, by the way, The Larry Miller Show, available on Apple Podcasts and Larry's website, LarryMillerPodcast.com. Also, Laughs for Bald Brian, or with Bald Brian. That's coming up November 2nd.
Featuring the great Larry Miller and Adam Carolla.
Larry Miller. Everyone's doing stand-up. Brian's even taking a stand-up class.
As people hear this tonight, I'll be doing my 5 minutes for Joe Coy.
All right.
Remember, he invited me and... Yeah. On stage at the Bray Improv. I'm extremely nervous. What?
Are we going to record it?
It's going to be filmed for the documentary. Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, okay. Extremely nervous.
Yes.
Where would that be? Like, I guess extremely nervous probably encompasses
it
all.
I am 28 hours ahead of time. I'm not super confident. Not the material. I think the material is okay. I think I've written some good material. It's the ability to perform it. You know what I mean? I'm not used to doing a lot of performing as a stand-up, so I'll be calming my nerves.
Larry and I will give you each one piece of sagely advice.
Please.
That hopefully will be different. I will say this. As far as being nervous, it's not going to go away, the adrenaline, the stuff, the material. The material's almost as good as they think you feel about it.
As you pitch it.
It's a weird thing. You can take technically good material and just sort of soft sell it and have it like, oh, he's not confident about that material. Right. So, but here's the thing. Your impulse is going to be to get through it, and you're going to end up powering through it. And the audience, they'll hang there as long as you want to hang. It'll feel weird sometimes as you're taking a pause or beat in between the punchline and the setup or the next thought or the next premise. It'll feel, 3 seconds will feel like an eternity.
Sure.
Audience likes that. They respond to it. The punchline lands much better. The biggest mistake you'll make is to have it all worked out and to just kind of, let's get through it. Your job is to get from A to B to C to D. Let it breathe. Okay. Now, it's hard to let it breathe. You can go out with your wife and have a nice dinner. When you're going out with a supermodel and it's your first date and someone says, don't talk so much and don't talk so fast.
That's in your head.
It's hard to do that. You know what I'm saying? You can do that now.
Right.
So it's hard to tell a guy who gets into the ring for the first time, don't panic and have the adrenaline dump and have all your... You can't. It just happens. Okay. But I will say to you, intellectualize it and literally have your 5 minutes take 8 minutes. Like, spread it out. And if they're laughing... Stop. Let them laugh. Don't roll right in. Just literally be conscious of
the rhythm of the
beat. Yeah. Take that long beat in between. Larry?
Well, my advice is run. Run away.
Come on, guys. Who knows this stuff?
Now, you know what?
How dare you?
That's all good advice. The things Adam said, it's true. You be backstage there, breathe in through the nose, out through the mouth, and, just say, hey, thank you. I belong here, and I'm really glad to be here. And then breathe again and say, here I go. And you've rehearsed it. You wrote it. You're good. People like you. So you know what?
Oh, Larry.
Oh, shush.
But also know that you haven't done stand-up, but you've been talking to a microphone for, some would say, too long. So you've got a lot. Not me.
Some would. There are some who would.
Obviously. Right. But not me. This would be killing.
It's a 51-49 situation.
My point is this. Don't go, oh, I'm so nervous about this situation. You've been on stage multiple times at big venues like the Moore Theater, many theaters around the country, speaking into a microphone. This is not much different.
Very cool.
There you go.
By the way, that's true, too. And just remember, don't be afraid. Smile. I mean, force a smile on backstage, behind the curtain, and say, here I go. And this is good. It's a good place to be. And then just do it. That tip, by the way, of, yeah, if they laugh when they're laughing, let them laugh. Don't roll over them, you know, with a big wheel. Right. Just be there.
I like that. Can I say two quick things? Mm-hmm. I wasn't going to take very long. Number one, funny, my comedy teacher, Jerry, I told him about this last week. He's like, I don't know if you're quite ready yet. And I was like, well, it might be better for the documentary if I actually do bomb. He's like, oh, good thinking. So we'll see how it goes.
That's a win-win.
Comedy teacher?
Yes.
That's a stupid thing to say.
He's comedy coach.
Jerry's a perfect name for him, though.
Yeah, Jerry with a G.
I don't know if you're ready yet. I don't know if you're ready yet to talk to me.
By the way, the book, Ralph, we're going to talk to about in a second, SEAL Team 6, Hunt the Leopard. We will talk about him and that. And he knows all that op stuff. We'll get into that right after this.
And now, another actual five-star iTunes review of the podcast, read by Adam's buddy, Oswaldo.
Regardless in the amount of the content they produce, Adam Carolla never failed to surprise even the most hardcore in the listening with the quick withering, brutally honest, and hilarious social commentary.
Eloquent and succinct. Go to iTunes, rate and review the podcast, and maybe Ozzy will butcher your review too. Now, back to the Adam Carolla Show.
Welcome back to the show, Ralph Pezzullo, his new book, which will be available soon, August 13th. So it's coming right up, and you can available now for pre-order on Amazon. Bookmark us and click through. It just helps. SEAL Team 6. Ralph's written over 15 books, on eighth on the SEAL Team series. Lots of interesting stuff to talk to Ralph about. So let's get into it. What is going on in that region of the world? I talked to Dylan about it a little bit. He said that Trump changed some of the rules of engagement. Now we're able to kill some more terrorists, which is which is good. He says you feel like China's going to implode soon. So we'll go in order. First off, we're killing more terrorists.
Well, it started with Syria. So, ISIS, had a big chunk of land in Syria. The Obama administration kind of held off getting involved, directly involved. The Assad regime in Syria was just, beating the hell out of the Sunnis. Really kind of an ethnic cleansing, like, situation there. And it created this huge humanitarian problem. Millions of refugees, terrible. And everybody was, 3-4 years ago, everybody was freaked out about ISIS. You know, they're taking over the world, they're taking over Syria, they're taking over Iraq. And we have something in the military called rules of engagement. So those are the orders that the troops get in terms of what they can do in particular situations. And the rules of engagement when Trump came into power were like, if you're a SEAL and you're in Syria helping the pro-democracy militias, which are mainly made up of Kurds, you can't engage in combat. You can only return fire if somebody's, shooting at you, type of thing. So Trump came in and he changed the rules of engagement. It's one of the first things he did when he was president. It happened in March of 2017. And he basically said, the gloves are off. We want to wipe out ISIS. We want to get them out of Syria. And so guys, if you see them, go after them. And that's what we started to do. I was explaining to Dylan that most of the combat today is done by private military contractors.
So most of the engagements,
yes.
The person holding the weapon,
yes.
For our side,
yes.
Would not be an enlisted soldier.
That's correct, yes.
Wow, that's a surprise to most people.
And that's true in Afghanistan, Iraq, Northern Africa. And the reason that
that's
there's
a little bit of a secret. I mean, not a secret,
it's
but it's not something
talked about
we don't
a lot.
Brag
yeah.
about it.
Right.
It's like when it's like when Budweiser buys Sam Adams or something. They don't put a little Budweiser logo on it.
Right.
They want everyone to think, oh no, that is that.
Yes.
We're not saying you can't look it up.
Yeah.
We're just saying we don't advertise.
Right.
Yeah.
Is that what it feels like?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's part of it is political. When you have bodies of American soldiers coming back from Syria, that makes headline news, right?
Right.
But if it's a private military contractor, nobody knows who the hell this guy is. He might be Peruvian. He might be from South Africa. He might be British.
What are the risks that are involved with having the private contractors as opposed to military? Or are there?
They're harder to control. It might be more expensive. I don't know
would
all the
these
economics
guys be,
of it.
Would they be called mercenaries?
Some people would call them mercenaries. They don't like to be called mercenaries. They like to be called private military contractors.
Of course.
So these guys are like former SEALs, former special forces. a former British special boat service, highly trained guys who are good at what they do.
I mean, in a way, it's like when you see a version of this in sports. A guy plays in the NFL, now he's a special teams coach for the Packers.
Right.
Politicians, a guy's a senator, now he's a consultant, a lobbyist, he's a pundit on CNN.
Yeah.
They're kind of, that's their business.
That's
they
right.
Stay
it's
in the
for
business.
A lot of these guys, like I know a bunch of them, and it's a way of continuing their career. You know, what else are they going to do?
That's
they're highly
they do.
Trained. I know a guy from British Boat Service, really interesting guy. Hurt his knee in a practice jump from a helicopter. They said, you got to leave the service. And one of his buddies called him up and said, hey, would you like to go to, where was it? Oman to do security, for the Sultan. And he's like, yeah, sure. What does it pay? You know, $20,000 a month. I'm there. All expenses taken care of.
Wow. Does the Boko Haram, Dylan was talking to me about as well, which famously kidnapped all the schoolgirls.
Yes.
We were interested for about 15 minutes, and then we moved on to who shot the lion or whatever the dentist was up to. You know, we focused. We got a little out of our lane for a minute, focusing about the 250 schoolgirls, and then we started really focusing on animals.
Yeah.
So now we don't give a shit about the girls anymore. There was a couple of tweets out there for a while. Where are those girls? What happened to them?
And a few of them were recovered. Most of them were sold into slavery, basically. Yeah, or taken. Taken as wives by Boko Haram militants. And there were, I think the initial kidnapping was 400 in 2016, and there have been a bunch of, there was one this year. So they still do it.
Describe Boko Haram. Who are they? What's different about that?
It's another Islamic, fundamentalist group. They have a very strict interpretation of the Quran. Basically, Boko Haram means no Western education, so they look upon Western education and the idea of freedom.
On a technicality.
Most of LAUSD.
Yeah, I'm born in North Hollywood, but I'm not educated.
Yeah.
This Etch-a-Sketch is clean. So fill it with whatever propaganda you like.
Those are the people they like.
Jesus Christ.
And they're like a lot of these groups, they operate in a Nigeria is a huge country, 200 million people, biggest, I think, seventh most populous country in the world. They operate in the northeast and a section of the country that is kind of ignored, and is very heavily. Nigeria is broke, kind of split between Christian and Muslim, and they operate kind of in a, Dust Bowl area of Nigeria. So they feel kind of disenfranchised. A lot of unemployment, and they, they feed on that. All these groups do.
Is the money basically the mafia, essentially? I mean, they'll do prostitution, they'll do drugs, they'll do gambling. Yeah. I mean, they'll do whatever's illegal they can get paid on. Is that what all these groups do?
That's what they all do. A friend of mine explained, when Syria... In Syria, first there was the Syrian Democratic Forces, and then they kept changing, and then it became ISIS. And I asked somebody who was there, I said, how does this work? And he goes, well, basically, you've got all these guys there are no jobs. So what do? You're hanging around, if you hang around, you're a target for somebody. And a group comes through and says, hey, I'll give you a pickup truck, I'll give you an AK-47, you can go into whatever village you want and, rape and plunder and do whatever you want. And these guys are like, okay, and we'll pay you,
So it's essentially a gang.
It's a gang.
I mean, it's a kid who doesn't have anything going on
That's
in his
right.
life. And
That's
they're
right.
a young male.
Yep.
And the opportunities are go get shot on the street or get hooked up with
Come
a gang.
With us,
hey,
yeah.
we have the same, we have the same.
Same thing.
Thing here in Southeast Los Angeles.
The things you're saying, they remind me a little bit because I'm so out of my depth with this conversation, but like the movie Beasts of No Nation.
Yeah.
And that really focused on literally children.
Kids, yes, yes.
Is that it, when it comes to Boko Haram and, you know, you're saying they're capturing these girls, they're capturing.
Yeah.
How many of the guys in it are kids?
A lot of them. Sure. They're
like, these aren't like, you know, 21, 22 year olds. Some of these are 10 year olds.
Yeah. It's like, you know, when are guys like filled with testosterone and just want to go out and, you know, raise hell? Not when you're 45.
Right. That's not what
you're
going to
have. You're going to have like a little a farm or something like right. that, or a car repair shop. But when you're, you know, 25, it's like, hey, let's get it on. Let's go. You know,
is there? It's so sad that it's. I keep thinking. Now here we are. We're a few months away from the year 2020. Yeah. And it's just still people just living on the dirt, shooting people, raping.
Yeah,
just
yeah, yeah.
Living the most.
We're
primitive.
In the future.
Yep.
We're in the future. It is 2020. Like if you when you were growing up, if you saw 2020 printed on a sign, you'd go, "That's the that number there.
That's
that
right.
is the future." Mm-hmm. People just raping. Kidnapping, slavery, sleeping on the dirt, shooting people, doing the worst things ever. I mean, they were like caveman shit, but now they have AK-47s.
Bust
right. a caveman with a don't need it. They got a full automatic.
That's right. That's right.
In a grenade launcher, like what?
Yeah.
What year is it? Why? And and then it, what? Like when does it end? Do we wait for the meteor to hit, or does something somehow fix something?
Yeah. Complex question. You know, people. You know, we all kind of have to wake up, like you know, to the realities. We love putting labels on things and going, okay, this is Islam. These are Islamic terrorists. This is this. This is. You know, and you have to just look at the personal reality of, you know, how these people are living and why they're making these decisions, whether it's in, you know, Chicago or it's in, you know, Syria or Iraq. So if you want, you know, if you want young men, who, and they're the ones who commit this kind of violence, if you want them to, you know, to be productive members of society, which probably a lot of them would prefer to be, right? You've got to give them those opportunities. They've got to have education. They've got to have, you know, an avenue to do something productive rather than sitting on a street corner and some guy driving up in a pickup and saying, hey, here's an AK-47. If you want to eat tonight, you know, come join us.
Let's talk SEAL Team 6.
Yeah.
Tell me about that book.
Okay, so I about like 2010, I got a call from a guy. He said, I've been, you know, in the SEALs, SEAL Team 6 for like 15 years. I've got all these stories, experiences. I can't really talk about them in, you know, publicly, but we could, you know, you could be a guy who could fictionalize these stories and turn them into thrillers.
Did they get Bin Laden? Was that SEAL Team 6?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And this is the guy actually who trained a lot of the men who got Bin Laden. Mm-hmm. So, and he's introduced me to, you know, other members, you know, people who were on that team who went into Pakistan. Yeah. And I've met some of them, they were like super casual about the whole thing. Like, that was no big deal.
Yeah. Well, that's always always the hero's mentality.
Yeah.
I'm always assume, or I do know, if I always like to say, if you talk to race car drivers or cage mixed martial art fighters or SEAL team guys, they're wired slow. They got low resting heart rate.
That's right.
I'm not talking about being in great shape. They're not agitated. Because once you're in, once the race starts, and once the cage door closes in the octagon, or once you start rappelling from the Huey, you cannot be wired.
Right.
You can't be wired like a lap dog.
Yeah.
You ever see like a Chihuahua with the eyes bulging all the time, like always looking.
Yeah.
Always
you're
doing that. That's a Tuesday in the living room. Wait till the shit goes down.
Right.
Your head will blow off.
That's
so when you catch these guys when the shit isn't going down.
Yeah.
We went to the Indy 500 a couple of years ago. We just happened to be standing with all the drivers in the sort of paddock before they were going to be introduced and come out. You know, the all access pass or whatever.
They're standing around in their fire suits and everything. They were cracking wise, walking around with each other. Yeah. And it wasn't a weird distraction mixed with bravado. Right. Like, oh, they're trying to cut the tension.
No.
They're just standing around talking. The first thing Mike August said was, what are these guys doing? They're about to cop in these cars, go 240 miles an hour. It's the most dangerous race in the world. And they're like, they're loose and laughing. Yeah. Like, they're downwired because when they get in the car, their head would explode.
Right. No, they actually train. They actually test people. There's an enzyme that your brain releases when you're when you feel any kind of fear, and it and these guys have a ton of it. So when you and I go like, I'm getting the hell out of here, man. This is scary, or you're freaking out. They calm. They actually calm down.
Wow.
Right.
So things slow down for them.
And what did they say? The gentleman that was in here, and now I can't think of his name.
I'm looking for the drop.
Slow is smooth and I'm sorry.
Something is smooth and smooth is fast.
Right, right. So they actually slow down, and they love that. They love that feeling, right?
Right.
And they can stay in control because they don't want guys who just, you know, go break into a house and just start like see somebody move and start shooting everybody.
Right.
They don't want that. Mm. They want the guy who's gonna go, you know, stay calm and still until he sees the barrel like pointed at his head, right?
Right.
And they medically select people like that, and they also train them to learn how to. I mean, the training is intense, and they train them to react, to slow everything down. They have something that's called the hood, so they get these guys and they put them in a garage. They put a hood over their face. And they'll have like three guys around them, and they know these guys are going to attack them. They're going to hit them, right? And they'll pull the hood off their face, and they have like a few seconds before these guys just start wailing on them, hit them in the face, hit them wherever, right? And in the beginning, and I know a lot of guys who have gone through this, and they go, it's like the scariest thing in the world, but you keep doing it, and you get pummeled. You keep doing it until your reactions slow down so much that even in that couple of split seconds, you are able to, you know, get your hands up, you're able to land punches, and they say it's like, you know, it's like nirvana.
It's like the Matrix.
Magic. It's like the Matrix, exactly. And so it's a real thing, and they just say when you can tap into that, you feel like a Superman, right?
Right.
Because everybody else is freaking out, and you're just, you know, super calm. And you see you can anticipate what the guy is going to do, and you can take him down or do whatever you have to do. And it's the whole thing is pretty advanced. But one thing when I met the members of SEAL Team 6, I was expecting these, you know, short haircut, you know, super American
machismo
guys. And they're not like that at all. They're like the guys in high school nobody wanted to have anything to do with, like the scary guys, like the motorcycle guys out all night, the wild men, right?
Do you have any thoughts? Yeah, there's a wiring. There's a weird danger wiring. Most people are wired to get away from it. Other people are wired to kind of seek it.
Yes.
It's the guys who I knew, and I was one of them when I was a kids, like our whole goal was we got to find an apartment building that has a pool near it so we can get on the roof and jump off the roof into the pool just because we're trying to shock ourselves into feeling something. Just before cable and U-porn, obviously.
Yeah.
Now, that's a gene. Some people have it.
Yeah.
I haven't told the story in a while, but it really, man, does it come out? My daughter, my son, you know, my son is a puss. My daughter's a thrill seeker.
Yeah.
And I realize it's so insanely evident. It was so clear when we're living, when the kids are, I guess they're about three, and it's that time when they like roughhousing and wrestling and everything. And my daughter would run across the bed, and the bed was a little high off the ground, you know, so like 2-3 feet off the ground. She'd go run across the bed, and she would launch herself head first toward me, and I had to catch her.
Yeah.
And my son liked to play that game too, but he wanted me to lean against the bed. Like, I want to make sure you catch me.
My
knees weren't making contact. Right. My gunt wasn't resting on the comforter, he wouldn't do it, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And my daughter kept telling me, move it back. Mm-hmm. Move it back.
Yeah.
And I was 8 to 10 feet away at a certain point. I'm strong and I'm kind of rangy and I felt pretty good. And she'd launch herself. But at a certain point, she said, move it back. And yeah. I said, I'm not going to catch you from here.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
she said, move it.
Yeah.
And
I said, you heard me.
I said, I will move it. I will do that.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
But I don't think I can get it.
Yeah.
And she said, I don't care.
I don't care.
Step it back.
Yeah.
And I stepped it back and she just fucking ate carpet. Now, I hope she doesn't do that as an adult because it'll take a turn for the sexual. But she just launched full Superman, Superwoman.
Yeah.
I did try to get her, but I couldn't get her from where I was.
Yeah.
And she just ate it.
Yeah.
Bad.
That's how you learn.
And then later, and this is where it gets weird. When I was within range of catching her, she'd launch herself in the air, and while she was midair, I would go, oh, mommy's home, and I'd pretend to start walking for the door, and I saw a look of terror in her face. Like, uh-oh. My landing, the guy's going to catch me, he's now walking away.
Right.
And I'd do it with my dog, you know, oh, Molly's in the room. And I kept doing it, and she'd go, don't do it.
Yeah.
Don't you do that.
Yeah.
And she'd run to the edge of the bed and she'd stop and go,
yeah.
You're so going to do that?
You too. Yeah.
She'd get back.
Yeah.
Don't you do it. After a while, she went, do it.
Yeah.
I want this.
I want to feel something.
I want to feel it. It's like, that's insane that she now wants this. She's already launched herself.
Yeah.
She wants extra fear.
Yeah. She's Bodhi from Point Break.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I was one of those guys. So there was just no fear. Like, you just would do you think about it later. You go, like, I tell my kids stories now, and they're just like, what?
Oh.
You know, what?
Just the just in the automotive world alone.
Yeah.
Just what you've done in a car that nobody should ever do again.
Right, right.
It's and insane. Ralph, you're going to hang with us. We're going to do, let me hit Geico, and then we'll do a little news. Let's see. Oh, I want to hear about China. You have an interesting thought about China.
Yeah,
Dylan was telling me.
Yeah, definitely.
Tell me.
Okay, so, you know, we love, and the media is, you know, this is a kind of like a reflex action now. We love to scare people. Like, we're always scaring
That's
people.
That's all we're talking
Just
about.
Talking
That's
about
all,
that.
Right, right. It's like, and people become all enslaved by fear. You know, it's everywhere.
It's everywhere.
You know, ISIS is a great example. Like, 4 or 5 years ago, they were taking over the world, and, like, we didn't have a chance. It was over. Now they're, you know, they're gone, basically. You know, they're
fringe group.
Fringe group, exactly. And now, and, you know, we've gone through the cycle with Russia. Like, Russia's a big threat, which is ridiculous because Russia's not the Soviet Union. It's like a tenth or a 20th of what it was in terms of a world power. And now we're shifting to China. And China, yeah, it's a huge country, huge economically, a billion and a half people, something like that. But, you know, I always tell people, look, you've got to consider, you know, the strength of our country is not our political system messed up, but the strength of it is how our society works, right? We still... You know, you can do, you have freedom, people can, you know, there's opportunity for people, much more than there is in other parts of the world. We're much more tolerant of one another than other people are in other countries. You know, China, the government controls everything. So they've got a situation now where they've had a lot of, you know, economic success. And so you've raised this whole class of young people who have education, who have money, who want to travel, who want to do things. They can't go on the internet.
Right.
Yeah, they can't travel without getting permission from their government. They can't. So this is kind of a classic situation in political science where whenever there are rising expectations of people and the government is not flexible enough to accommodate those expectations, there's inherent conflict. And we're seeing
this is Star 80, man.
Yeah, yeah.
You got a hot blonde girl.
That's right.
And you're some low-level producer. You're going to bring her to Hollywood. You're going to introduce her to Hef and a bunch of directors. She's going to outgrow you, man.
That's the same thing.
Careful what you wish for.
That's right. That's how it works.
You got to watch out. The citizens Chip is getting too smart, too savvy,
too educated, whatever.
Right. How long are they going to live under this regime? How long before they start sucking off Bogdanovich instead of you? You know what I mean?
That's what I got from that.
And so you're seeing like the precursor. Like you look at what's going on in Hong Kong, right? The Chinese government is trying to you know clamp down on the freedoms of the people in Hong Kong. They're saying no. We're not gonna take it. So you've got to believe that everybody in China who has a computer and has access to this information is watching this really carefully, and they're going, you know, what's the government gonna do? Are they gonna crack down on these people? And the government is in this kind of, you know, impossible situation, because if they crack down on it, then people in China know, like, well, the only way we're going to get our freedom is we're going to have to go out in the street and we're going to have to kick ass, right? Or are they going to back down? And if they back down, then what are the people in China going to do? They're going to start petitioning their government for the same kind of freedoms that the people in Hong Kong had. So, you know, they're caught in this dynamic that I don't think they can sustain for... You know, I don't know when it's gonna blow, but it's gonna happen.
You know, all roads lead to raising the daughter. But I used to tell people when I did Loveline all the time, look, if you tell your daughter who's 17, her curfew's 8 o'clock at night, she's climbing out the window.
Right,
man.
Of course.
You have to. Well, you go. I don't want her coming home at 4 a.m. Fine. Right. We gotta find a number.
Right.
That works. It can't be 8.
That's
She'll
reasonable.
Go out the window.
Yeah.
She might not go out the window immediately, but she's going to go.
Right.
Look, especially when she gets information, starts hearing about parties and seeing what other people are doing.
Sure.
You can't do it for that long. Now. When she goes out the window, you'll wish you'd just set a 1 a.m. curfew.
Right.
And that's what I want to kind of tell all these horrible, you know, republics. I could please, let's just be reasonable.
That's right.
Or it's not going to work.
Well, this is the universal, like, you go anywhere in the world, and I've traveled a lot, and I've lived in a lot of other countries. Everybody basically wants the same thing. They want to be able to have, you know, more freedom. They want to be able to... have a better life for themselves and their kids and live in, you know, basically a peaceful situation. And when you restrain that, you're just kind of bottling up like this negative energy that at a certain point is going to explode.
Well, what China has that makes it different than some of the other areas we're talking about is they have money, they have technology, they have education. When you're talking about Boko Haram, that's a whole different kettle of fish, right? Like, how do we ever get those people from there to here to there? But these people are already there, minus the freedom. And so for that reason, you're saying it's impending.
It's impending. It's almost more dangerous, right? Because if you say, hey, you know, I'm making all this money, I'm working hard, I have a good education, I hear what's going on in the rest of the world, why can't I go on Google? Why can't I go on YouTube? Why does the government have to, you know, block all that stuff from me?
Would you compare it at all to the Arab Spring? Because those were educated sort of college kids, and we've already seen what they can do.
Right, exactly. Same kind of situation. Like, I have, I wrote a book about North Korea a couple years ago, and I spoke to a lot of experts, and I'm like, what's going to take down, like, this regime? Like, what are you doing? And they were like, you know, it's such a closed society. They live, you know, it's bizarre. It's a bizarre friggin' country. But the most effective thing that we found, there are these groups that get a bunch of thumb drives, right? And they load all these American, like, TV shows on them. And they get a bag, plastic bag of them, and they cross the river from China into North Korea. And they just start distributing these things. These are opposition groups, you know, North Koreans who have left. And the North Korea propaganda is such, and the Chinese do the same thing. It's like, well, you know, the United States, there's constant race wars, there's violence everywhere, everybody's, you know, they can't leave their houses and so on and so forth. When these people see, like, an American TV show, whether it's Friends or whatever the hell it is, and they see the way these people are living and they're...
Well, I hope they don't get Alf.
Yes.
That's going to blow their minds. These guys are living with aliens.
That's right.
I don't want that.
It's a small wonder.
Oh, no, the world's
It reminds us of our leader. Yeah. It's when they see that, they go, hey, this is cool. Like, yeah.
I know. Yeah. The propaganda is insane. Yeah. Although we do propaganda to ourselves. We never stop talking about the Klan and white supremacy.
Oh,
and everyone's oh, yeah. But you look around and you're like, where, who?
No, I know. I was visiting my aunt a couple weeks ago, and she's like, you know, super paranoid about the American Nazi Party or something like that. And I said, how many people do you think are members of the American Nazi Party? And she goes, oh, millions.
Mm. Millions.
And I said, well, let's Google it. We Googled it. It was like 600. And I said, this is a threat to our country.
You couldn't fill a AAA, you really, a baseball stadium with the Nazis and the KKK and all that.
Yeah.
We never stop fucking ourselves up. We just never stop. It's one of these things, too, where it's like, same thing with secondhand smoke.
Mm. Yeah.
57,000 people die every year. I've never seen a person or heard about a person who's died of secondhand smoke. I've never met anyone affiliated with one of these groups or knew someone whose dad was in the Klan or any of that, anything even close to that. So how?
Right.
It's ubiquitous, except for nobody has a story of like, I flew southwest to Phoenix and there's a whole group of Klansmen on the plane.
Land.
The
we
guy's horse was taken up the aisle. It was a bitch. Like, you know, when you run into a bunch of Klansmen and there's like a convention or something.
Can't get the hood out of the overhead
bin. And if somebody said, like, what about Hasidic Jews? Yeah. I'd be like, yeah, I've seen a few.
A
couple walking around. Yeah, a few more than I'd care to see. Yeah, I'm with you, Brian.
When I was in fourth grade, my dad was assigned to Washington for a while, and we lived on a street in Arlington. And at the end of this block at Wilson Boulevard, which is the main street, was the American Socialist Party headquarters. And it was like a storefront. And every Saturday, a bunch of guys would stand out there, and they'd fly the Nazi flag, and they'd be in their uniforms. And this is, you know, like the late 60s. And people would drive by and, like, throw stuff at them, right?
Right.
And it was a joke.
Yeah. If you want to get stuff thrown at you, just go get in a Nazi outfit and go walk anywhere in the country. Like, if you'd like to know what this country universally thinks of Nazis, go get in a Nazi outfit and go march in any town USA and see how you're received. Okay.
Right.
What that means is, we generally don't like these people in this country. It doesn't mean there aren't any.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, let me hit Geico. Everyone's got the to-do list. How about you save hundreds of bucks on your car insurance, and you don't have to go anywhere. Just go to geico.com. 15 minutes, you could be saving 15% or more on your auto insurance. Take that extra money, put it in your pocket, save it for a rainy day. That's the most rewarding thing you can do all day, every day. It is Geico.com. All right, let's take a quick break and do the news right after this.
All right, we're running the ads.
The news with Grad. News with Gino Grad. Breaking viral. All those crazy Trump tweets. Give me news with Gina Grad. Trouble in the Middle East. Celebrity drunk meltdowns. Need news with Gina Grad.
The news with Gina Grad.
Well, we just had Danny Trejo in here, and he is in the news today. Played a real-life superhero in L.A. on Wednesday by saving a baby trapped inside an overturned car. So the actor was kind of in the right place at the right time. Two cars collided in Sylmar, California, not far from here. One of the vehicles flipped over, left the child stuck in the car seat flipped over. Trejo crawled into the wreckage but wasn't able to unbuckle the car, so another Good Samaritan, I believe her name was Martha, entered the car from the other side. She unbuckled it.
Her name was Martha, and she was in Sylmar?
Yeah, she's like
a nurse and was driving home.
You know who she looks like? This won't mean anything to any of you.
She didn't live in Sylmar.
Well,
she's driving. She can't be named Martha.
I thought that was her name. She looks like
Martha.
She's in both Handmaid's Tale and Orange Is the New Black. I mean, she's not this chick, but she looks like her.
Now,
like
a really cool, I love Trejo, but he is of Hispanic descent.
He is.
Now look.
You sure?
Are you sure he wasn't breaking into the car and stealing the baby? Or I'm asking. Ernest T. Bigot is asking.
Just asking.
I'm just asking.
Okay.
I don't know.
Unclear.
And neither do you, quite
unclear.
Frankly.
Unclear. You're right. But the child and the grandmother were reportedly taken to the hospital, non-life-threatening injuries. So Trejo later told ABC7 that he kept the little boy calm, saying they had to use their superpowers, show me your muscles. So this is a little bit of Danny talking about that.
And the grandma had been thrown from the driver's side to the passenger side.
She's wearing a lot of merch.
And she was just screaming, my baby, my baby, my baby. And that was my lines in Storks. My baby, my baby, my baby. I couldn't Storks. Open the back door. It was crushed. And so this big Mexican dude, he came and we said, come on, we can do this. And then we ripped it open together. And I thought, boy, I'm glad that guy wasn't my cell partner.
Okay, there was another
takes
interview.
A turn for the homoerotic.
always. There was another interview with him right outside the scene, and this lady came up to him and he said, this is the woman who did it. So maybe there was a few people that helped.
Let's see if it's Martha.
I have that clip.
Get out the way. Get out the way.
He was really clearing out people out of the way.
Clearing out that car.
So Martha.
He's a big.
Kids and everyone's good.
Yeah, everybody's fine, I guess.
Silmar, good.
So for the fourth time in history, the Primetime Emmy Awards are going hostless.
Was Trejo, do you think he lives in Sylmar? Like, that'd be the equivalent of OJ living in South Central at the height of his powers. You know what I mean? Like,
but Trejo's a man of the people.
True.
He's keeping it real.
He has murals. Point,
you move in up on top of the hill next to Seth MacFarlane and Mary Blondo, you know, right?
Not Danny.
Okay. I mean, if he's driving through Sylmar, he's keeping it real because that is the barrio.
Does he have a location out there? Is he going to, you know, do a site visit?
Trejo's Tacos. Mm-hmm.
Could be. There are definitely some tacos.
Are there taco
consumed.
Joints out there?
Definitely the Spawn Ranches out there.
That's in between Chatsworth and Simi. Mm. The Santa Susana Pass.
But who knows?
I used to work out there. Yeah.
So Fox, which carries the ceremony this year, and the Television Academy have decided to not have a host. It's going to take place on September 22nd. They justified the news by saying, quote, if you have a host in an opening, that's 15 or 20 minutes you can't have to salute the shows. The last time the Emmys went without a host was 2003. They did it in 98. They did it in 75. This year's Academy Awards, which were hostless by necessity after the whole Kevin Hart thing, likely the inspiration after the tighter ceremony ran smoothly and saw a ratings bump. So they're going to follow along.
Yeah. I mean, there's always going to be a novelty factor if there's a whole bunch of news about not having a host, and then there's going to be a bunch of curiosity.
Right.
You're going to get a ratings bump because everyone's going to go, what's this like? Right. How's it going to be? That's fine. I don't know. Can we just get, you know what we should do? I think here's where we're at. Who's that comedian? Hannah Gadsby was her name?
Yeah, the Nanette special.
Let's just put her in like a three-piece suit and go, that's our new host. We don't know
all
what she
shows.
Is.
Yeah.
That could be a woman, could be a man, could be everything.
Could be jokes, could be cautionary
tales.
There's
not going to be any Me Too stuff attached to this. Nobody's anything. We'll just have her. Yeah. We'll just host everything. And we'll create, the script will be created by, you know, we'll get
AI
like two
robot.
Black writers.
Oh.
Two,
yeah.
Well, no.
Oh, that's an AI robot.
Well, yeah,
those are racist,
jokes.
Brian. We've talked about that.
So we're just going to get two of everything and then a non-conforming.
Like Noah's Ark.
It's someone who's transitioning and everyone will do two jokes and then she'll spit them out on stage and then no one will be
Noah's
able to be no one will be able to be outraged. Oh, one of the tweets, I think it was it Rosanna Arquette?
Oh, she apologized for being white. Oh, yeah, it says, I'm sorry I was born white and privileged.
Me.
It disgusts me, and I feel so much shame.
Oh, my God.
Now, because I'm a human being and I have brain cells to rub together, I read that and went, oh, good for her. She's taking a poke at the system. Like, she's making a
joke. She's not joking, I don't think, unfortunately.
My first blush was, oh, she's making a joke.
Yeah.
Good for her.
Yeah.
And then I realize, oh, Toto, we're not in Kansas anymore.
Yeah.
Come on with the reference.
It's a great song.
Yeah, it is.
All right, so she meant it.
She meant it.
Yeah.
That's sad.
That is sad. She did have some privilege, though, growing up in that acting
family. Yeah, she's an Arquette. There might be privilege there. Who knows?
All right.
No, keep it going, Brian. All right. So an artisan vodka has been produced with ingredients, special ingredients. We've been talking about a lot of artisan liquor lately.
Let me ask you this.
Yeah.
If you're really upset over how you're born, like in terms of your skin tone, do you walk around feeling that way like all day, every day? That's not a weekends and holidays kind of upset. That's unless you figure out a way to crawl out of your own asshole, you're living with that one. Is that an all day, every day?
Yeah,
it's kind of a low grade.
Yourself.
Yeah.
Kind of like radon poisoning or something. No. Like just walk around
the
your house
killer.
Going, I don't feel right.
The question is, does she really feel that way? Does she? Or is she saying it to be
well, I'm
going to
say she
whatever.
Doesn't. Here's here's what. Here's what I'm going to say. If she really felt that way, she just, that's the way I feel. I don't think she shares it with people.
It's a personal shame.
I feel like it's a personal thing, and it's a shame, and it's maybe something you don't want people to know.
This is textbook virtue signaling.
It is. And if you think about the stuff you really know and you really feel, you kind of keep that close to your vest.
Especially if it's shame.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Or regret or whatever.
Specifically,
I thought the goal of all this was sort of self-acceptance, no matter, you know, what you were, right?
It's quite the opposite.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and none of it is ever like, I went to a Outback Steakhouse, I ordered about $90 worth of grub, and I really stiffed the shit out of the waiter, so what are you going
to
do? Like, it's not traditional shame.
I feel terrible.
I feel terrible.
Yeah.
They all should know.
It's not that. It's always this.
Yes.
Yeah.
How about just some everyday shame?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Took an extra newspaper.
Just be a better person. Shame. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, this artisan vodka.
No one says, like, I went to a Super Bowl party. I did have, like, four IPAs, and I hit the road. My kids were in the car. So I feel kind of stupid. I made it home fine, but I do feel kind of stupid about that. I
mean, shouldn't do it again. It.
No one says that.
No.
But they do that.
Yes.
But they announce this.
Yes.
Okay. Just want to keep it clear how it works. All right.
Well, in your next sports viewing party, you might want to grab yourself a bottle of this. It's ingredients from the Chernobyl exclusion zone.
Yes.
And scientists insist that it's safe to drink, according to CNN.
Oh, wow.
Scientists from the University of Portsmouth created atomic vodka, a spirit made with exclusion zone grain and water, making it the first consumer product to come from that area around the abandoned nuclear plant. Chernobyl is the site of the world's worst nuclear disaster, which resulted in thousands of deaths. The researchers insist the vodka's safe, although the team found some radioactive activity in the grain.
Feels like a gimmick, I'll be honest.
Which is above the Ukrainian limit. I don't even know what our limit is.
They ought to market that to people with white guilt. That's what I say.
Oh,
yeah. Slowly kill yourself.
That's right.
Yeah.
I saw a horrible Chevy Chase movie called Modern Problems.
You can just say Chevy Chase movie.
A Chevy Chase movie called Modern Problems. We can all guess.
Was this the one with Dan Aykroyd? Is that what I'm thinking of?
There are many, many of those. This wasn't that.
Okay.
This is Chevy Chase is like an air traffic controller or something. He's driving home from his crappy job. He stops. The truck in front of him says, like, nuclear waste, like hazardous material. And, like, it's slopping on him. And it slops on him. And then, of course, when he gets home, instead of getting cancer and dying, he has clairvoyant powers.
Yeah.
He can, like, manipulate things using his mind.
Yeah, that's what we like to hear.
And all that kind of stuff. And it's just like, it's first off, I get it. It's 1987, but it's not 1919. You know what I mean? Like, this is modern times.
Someone Tesla.
Somebody made The Godfather. We made films
quite a while ago
that were good. They did Rocky. They did all of them.
Platoon was last year.
On the waterfront. They did them all. What are we doing with this one? Yeah. And the premise of having nuclear waste dumped on you, he's literally driving his car and it's like, oh, sorry, 1981. He's got like the windshield wiper, like, oh, man, with the green sludge.
Yeah. He doesn't pull over.
Now look at him.
Read the byline of that.
So that's what happens.
All right. Jealous, harried air traffic controller Max Fielder, recently dumped by his girlfriend, comes into contact with nuclear waste and is granted the power of telekinesis, which she uses not only to win her back, but to gain a little revenge.
Wow.
All right. Thick plot.
This is modern. This is him driving.
They remade this. This is what women want.
I wonder... You also wonder about, like, Chevy Chase, too. It's like, you have a sense of humor. He's just driving behind a car, a truck. It's this nuke waste on it.
Gives him the power and a green light
Wow.
It's true.
To get even.
Oh, he's telekinetic.
Dabney Coleman.
Now he's out of control. And about to make this the funniest Christmas ever.
Wow.
This is demon powder. Now, he touched that, he died.
That was Chevy Chase.
Nobody knows.
Is that
Chevy Chase? He's got hot brains.
That should be a meme. Someone contact the meme guys.
Patty Darbinville.
Did you see that?
Mary Kate Place.
I'm Max.
Nell Carter. And Dabney Coleman. Modern Problems.
I blew it. I was a bad boy.
Modern Problems.
All right. You know, I'm going to sit down with my goddamn kids and go, you know how you get to watch Avengers Endgame at the theater? This is what I had to fucking watch. Do you now feel sorry for your father and realize why I'm constantly upset and angry and disappointed at life? Yeah. Wow. This is what we had.
Yeah.
This
yeah.
is what we had to yeah. watch.
That's your uphill yeah. both ways.
You just watched Hobbs and Shaw. This is what we had to watch, son. Yeah. This was our entertainment.
Raw heroes.
Just getting raw waste dumped on him. And by the way,
well, that's how you haul raw nuclear waste.
Yeah,
right?
It's like his skin wasn't irritated at all. He just was
just got special
telekinesis. Yes, awesome.
The movie I was thinking of was nothing but trouble.
Yes.
Problems.
Oh, yes.
Remember Funny Farm?
I remember that.
They're all the
Funny
same.
Farm. Yeah.
Yeah.
John Candy was in that.
That's
one.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, Monica Jackson, not Martha Jackson.
Oh, thank you.
Which helps, but the Jackson is still screwing me up now. She must have been driving through. What's her profession? Nurse. Driving home. She's not living there. She's driving home.
So, find out.
Go ahead.
All right. So Fox News reports that a bat caused quite a scene when it was discovered on a Spirit Airlines flight recently. According to a Spirit Airlines spokesperson, the stowaway was discovered about 30 minutes into a flight from North Carolina to New Jersey. A statement sent by Fox News to Fox News by Spirit says, quote, "It is believed the bat started its journey in Charlotte, flying into an overhead bin while our crews were doing overnight maintenance. Passengers tweeted the video. Everybody's freaking out. The bat's flying around, and I think we have video of that for you."
Bats are very erratic in their flying.
You see them.
I love that everyone's scared of bats.
Yeah.
This is creepy.
That's so. And they're the opposite of pelicans. Yeah. They're totally erratic in their flight.
Yeah.
The pelicans are always like just kind of smooth and easy and just skimming above the water. You never know when they're going to scratch a cornea.
They eventually caught it in the bathroom, removed the bat when it landed. No one was hurt, including the bat. They wanted to make sure everyone knew.
I was listening to an expert this morning on a radio show. Do you know the creature that has claimed the most human lives?
Yes. I have a guess.
I'm going to guess, too. I heard this a while ago.
Wait,
hippopotamus.
On the count of three, Brian.
Oh.
Hippopotamus.
Yeah. Into the realm of millions and billions.
That's crazy.
Human beings.
Yeah.
Not the hippo.
Oh, not the
hippo.
Oh. Wow.
No. Yeah, I heard the hippo too.
Well, no. I guess historically I would say if you're counting like bubonic plague, I said the rat.
Ah, interesting.
Yeah, I would
you're
say
on the
right
track.
Yeah, yeah.
The mosquito.
Mosquito.
At least on the right track.
Hypothesized that half the world's population taken out by mosquitoes.
Interesting.
Wow. Half.
Wow.
I'll buy it.
Wow.
Half the people who have ever been on this planet.
My God.
I'm sure it's less now.
Yeah.
Right.
But half.
Yeah.
By a mosquito.
Jesus.
Female mosquito, Gina.
Of course.
The dudes are chillaxed.
Like, you don't even feel them.
The dudes.
Silent.
Yeah. You welcome them at first.
The dudes actually like pollinate a little bit.
Yeah,
like,
they do a little good.
They try to help.
Sure.
They're trying to offset the damage the ladies are doing.
Right.
But,
she's just living
luck
off.
To them.
Yep.
So once again, we have a situation.
She's the real Black Widow.
The danger.
Yeah. I mean, everyone focuses on Boko Haram and they're all dudes, right? Yeah, what about the mosquitoes?
Guess little what lives
mosquitoes.
Over there?
Yeah.
Mosquitoes.
Lots of mosquitoes.
Yep. They take everybody out.
Yeah. My God.
I know.
Well, they would take out whole armies.
Yeah.
Like, I mean,
You
lose three quarters of your army to a mosquito.
That's right. That's right.
Makes sense, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, let me just tell everyone to hit the Podcast One survey real quick at podcast1.com. study. You take a couple minutes, give a little info, and the first 125 people that complete the survey are going to get a $20 gift card to restaurants.com, and one of them is going to get a $100 Amazon gift card. So take a second, go to podcast1.study and get that gift card. All right, Gina, what else?
Well, as part of its Green Week celebrations, Frontier Airlines has announced that anyone with the last name Green is eligible for a free flight.
How about them not flying for a week? puts a lot
better.
Of carbon in the air,
yeah,
right?
No, this is
jet
better.
A, right?
Yeah, it's not really
better.
It's not really the spirit of things. However, the offer does come with a few caveats, the biggest being that eligible participants have to fly between August 13th and August 20th, so hurry up.
Can I say this? I'm not one of those douchebags who goes like, oh, Al Gore. Are you talking about the environment? You live in a big house with the light bulbs. I'm not one of those guys. And I'm not one of those, whenever they do the Helsinki, you know, environmental summit and all the celebs
right.
fly in on
private.
A private jet. I'm all right with part of it. But how much does Oprah and DiCaprio, like, really have to offer in the way of science? You know what I mean? Like, I don't need
probably.
Cheerleaders flying in on private
right.
fucking jets.
Yeah.
Like, I get the part. It's a big carbon footprint, the private jet. And if we got some scientist who's in, you know, Germany and he needs to fly
if
in.
Hawking
and
was around.
Crunch a few
something.
Numbers. Yeah. Get some guy.
Like Katy Perry?
Yeah, what do we need Katy Perry for?
We'll Skype you in.
Yeah.
right.
That's a very good point.
You stay stateside, sweetie. Come on now. Get one of them bras that shoots whipped cream and just hang out.
Yeah. Chill by the pool.
Yeah, yeah. Chill out.
Write a song.
I'm not into the carbon footprint, but we could shrink right. it if those celebs didn't go together.
That's right. That's a good point.
Or to those events, yes.
They got a carpool at least. Mm-hmm.
The plane pool, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know what they do with those things.
I honestly don't know.
Yeah. I think they're just there to be seen.
To raise
right?
awareness. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Good optics.
And to feel important, too.
Right.
Right.
Yep.
You're the select group.
And then at some point, they end up on a yacht.
Yeah, that's right.
So it's like, I don't know. I'm starting to wonder what's going on.
Yeah.
Here.
It's not great for the ocean.
It's Jeffrey Epstein's not involved.
Well, let's put
right?
it this way. If there's if there's something called an environmental summit and I would blow you to go, something's going on there that's not work. You know what I mean? Because regular summits are boring as shit. The food is bad, and it doesn't involve yachts and private jets. It's super. You don't want to go to these things.
Right.
Is it a Holiday Inn that you've never
right.
heard
you fall
of?
Fall asleep in the
There's a box lunch.
right.
With some processed cheese product in a little cup, you know.
Right, that's been sitting there for a week.
Yes, if you want to go to the summit, I'm suspicious.
That's a good
point.
That's
what I'm saying.
Yeah, mm-hmm. makes sense.
Mm-hmm. All right, what's another?
All right. Well, an internet provider is offering a one-weekend job to someone willing to take a weekend vacation from their phone and computers. SatelliteInternet.com said the, quote, Digital Detox Challenge is offering $1,000 to someone willing to spend a weekend at Joshua Tree National Park in Southern California, but they have to give up any tech devices for 2 days. I've already applied. The selected person
that was Gina running away.
will be put up at a little retro Airbnb, and they can hike, and they can meditate or sit in a hammock or whatever they want.
This is about drugs.
Probably, but the last day, because nothing's free around here, the company says in true millennial style, you can pull out your tech on the last day and document the experience of how great it was to not have your phone and make sure you know that it's courtesy of satellite internet.
How are you going to document it if you can't use your phone?
On the last day, you're allowed to tell people all about this wonderful, benevolent company that gave you this opportunity.
Okay.
Do you guys think there's a, I'll tease this. I started to think, like, half the shit I get on my phone is just negative. Somebody is like, oh, they want to know if you're sign off on the... It's like,
well, if you count
like
Twitter, absolutely.
Pain in the ass. Even text and whatever. Like, okay, let's say half of it is negative or more than half is negative. Considering then this device brings you bad news more than 50% of the time, why can't we walk into the bathroom without holding it in our hand?
Yeah.
And now, I understood if it's a box of good news, then you'd feel like I constantly want to see it.
Yeah.
But it's a kind of a box of negativity, which probably draws you, the moth, closer to the flame.
It's not, and it's the Twitter experience. Like, not, let's just forget about people just talking shit. They're literally saying you suck or whatever. How about just people sending us stuff like, hey, here's a story that'll piss you off. Here's something you're talking about on the podcast that you'll hate.
I hate this.
Yeah, exactly. You get those all the time. Like, oh, you're going to hate this. Like, what a miserable experience that is.
I also.
Give me more. Yeah.
Exactly.
I do realize there's a, here's an interesting thing. So whenever somebody says to me something they did with their parents, I pass it through my parents' prism and filter. Mm-hmm. So if somebody says, I went on a cruise with my mom, I go, oh, fuck.
You poor thing.
Fuck, man, that's rough. That is fucking rough.
You get a medal
couldn't
you for
do,
that.
Like, couldn't you just throw yourself down some stairs before the cruise left and say you had a compound fracture and get out? And they go, I like my mom. And I go, okay.
I'm sure you do.
I'm sure you do. Yeah.
She's not here. You don't have to say that.
Yeah. Brutal. Yeah. So, but that's me passing it through my filter. And I realize everyone must think I'm a douchebag. Because I go, well, I'll be on Twitter, and they'll go, people are haters, man. They are hot. They are rough. And I go,
don't take it for face value.
You can't listen to what people are saying about you. And I go, they're pretty cool for the most part. And I go, you can't listen to what those, you know.
Don't let it get to you.
Everyone talks shit. And I'm like, oh, you must think I'm a douchebag. Thus, I create.
Right.
All of this. The reality is most people are nice and somewhat informative, and for me at least, and they point out things where, hey, the guy from Fridays isn't
not Terry
Crews, it's tiny, whatever, black simile.
You but dumb bitch.
It's not that much.
Yeah.
But I realize everyone who says to me, you can't listen to all the haters, must think I'm a douche.
That's right.
Thank you.
Haters to listen to.
All right. Let me hit the Castrol Edge. Stronger under pressure. Castrol Edge. Three times, fool. Stronger than leading full synthetic. And viscosity breakdown. And they did a test. And it is three times better than leading full synthetics. Edge formula always exceeds the toughest industry standard. So pour some of that gold into your crankcase, man. It is Castrol Edge. All right, one more, Gina Grad.
All right, let's end on some good news. If you were planning on going to Spain, it would be a good time to go because it is now okay for women to bathe topless in Barcelona's city-run pools. Authorities just confirmed this after complaints that some swimming spots were discriminating against those who wanted to bear a little more. In a report released at the end of June, several municipal pools were found to have rules that restricted women's rights in certain areas of the facility. They did not like that. So as a result, the council's office against discrimination sent a report to every municipal pool reminding them to guarantee equality and not prevent women from going topless.
And, I'm trying to think of what quality, like, you know, like when me and Dr. Drew used to hit colleges, you'd go to Northern DeKalb and it was pretty rough sledding in the co-ed department, you know.
Sure.
But then you hit Arizona, and as Drew would say, a lot of talent on campus. A lot of talent on campus. He's a passionate man. So Spain says hot chick, but public pool doesn't really ring that bell. You know what I mean? Kind of makes me wonder.
Right.
Because the hot chick, she's at the resort, and she's on the beach or whatever.
Maybe
the public pool, I don't know.
Maybe the public pools are like upscale over there?
Don't know. No, they got to be better than our public pool.
Oh, absolutely. A low bar.
We got to send Chris to Barcelona, do a little recon,
let
us know.
I like the concept of a public pool to the poor kid. Here's one more thing you'll never have. Enjoy it temporarily.
Share it with all your friends and strangers.
Before you head back to your sweat box, enjoy this.
You know what happened to us every GD summer of my life? Because we grew up right next to the public pool, and as my mom always said, we said, why didn't we go to camp? You had pool patches.
Right.
And they sew the little patch, and you go, and you stay there all day. Every summer, every first day of the pool, kids are lined up around the street, freaking out. It's so hot. It's Kansas. We can't wait to go in. Every summer, they go, oh, sorry, pool's closed today. Someone threw a bunch of glass into the pool, and we got to start over. Every time, they couldn't prepare for this and see this coming for the next year.
Yeah, there's that.
The
it's kind of like Disneyland when you show up. And like, oh, Space Mountain is not, we're not running.
What are we doing here, then?
Yeah. And by the way, there's never a follow-up question. You walk away shaking your head. No one ever refunds any money.
No one ever goes,
tell me exactly what is wrong with Space Mountain. Just what the ETA on fixing it is.
So what's wrong with Matterhorn?
Yeah. Oh, you put a cone in front of it? Okay.
Well,
Well, then we'll
no
go
questions.
Ride something lame.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mr. Toad's Wild Ride.
All right. Gina, I say you get on over to Barcelona and hit, hit one of those pools.
Can do.
Mamma mia.
All right. Let's bring it home.
You got it. I'm Gina Grad, and that's the news.
Gina Grad.
That was the news with Gina Grad.
Simply Safe. Go to simplysafe.com/Adam and get started peeling stick up and running in under an hour. We all use Simply Safe. Two eyes. Simplysafe.com/Adam. All right. We're going to do a dark week and play Carolla Classics. I'm in Monterey racing Porsche 935. So I'll be racing, and you guys will be enjoying Gio and Chris Maxpada with Carolla Classics. They're all good. And when you're in Monterey, come out to Laguna Seca and find me. I'll be in the paddock. I'll be hanging around my car doing something.
Low resting pulse, conversational.
Totally friendly, totally easy. Mm-hmm. It's a cool vibe. Mm-hmm. Big crowd, fun. Totally approachable. Come by, say hi. I'll let you sit in the car if you want.
Nice.
How about that? All right, Ralph, the book we should tell everyone about, SEAL Team 6, Hunt the Leopard. It's available for pre-order now on Amazon, coming out in a few days, but that'll be August 13th. Ralph Pezzullo, PEZZULLO.com for all of Ralph's stuff coming up. Dawson.
We should also say that Ralph co-wrote Ghost with Michael R. McGowan, the 30-year FBI undercover agent we had in.
Yeah.
I did that audiobook and also Left of Boom.
That's right.
With Douglas Ratliff, available on Audible.
Oh, and I got to hit the taco truck. Damn it, I just forgot. Sorry.
Javier's. Delicious.
Came by and made us some amazing tacos. So Javier's Tacos. I don't know if you just hit a .com or just Google it.
Search.
Javier's Tacos.
And
yeah, they
Javier's
were,
Prime Tacos.
They were a cut above.
And he goes, I heard, you know, with you people and the keto and the low carb, try this. He made basically a crepe, a beautiful stuffed taco that was stuffed instead of a tortilla and fried cheese.
Oh,
God, it blew my mind.
Wow. So good. Wow. So, until next time, Sam for Ralph, Gina, and Bald Sam. Mahalo. Nope to soap.
Stick around. Today's episode of Good Sports with Dave Damashek and Adam Carolla is coming right up.